Hi, David. I am joined right now by Sarah Jaffe. She is a labor journalist and the author of two books, one from 2016 called Necessary Trouble, Americans in Revolt. And most recently, which is the book that I'm going to be talking to her about today, Work Won't Love You Back, How Devotion to Our Jobs Keeps Us Exploited, Exhausted, and Alone, which was out earlier this year, I think, in January. And I encourage all of our listeners to pick this book up. It's an excellent read, and there is also an audio version, which Sarah herself reads, which is really fun too. So thank you for joining us, Sarah. This is the UK branch of the David Feldman Show.
Hi, yeah, thank you for having me.
So let's get into the book. I recently read your book and found it revelatory, really. I think it's obviously extremely timely, given what we've all been through with the pandemic, to talk about work in this way. But more broadly, I think it offers a really sharp kind of political and social analysis of what you call the labor of love ideology, which we'll talk about. But what I loved about it is it has this very sort of sensitive approach to these questions that sort of accounts for what it means to be human and asks kind of big questions about what it means to be human in this economy, and does so with a real kind of reverence for, I think, human connection and love and care. So I found the combination of those things very powerful. First of all, I want to ask you, well, to define the labor of love ideology and also tell us what you kind of set out to do in this book, what your aims were.
Yeah, so, you know, I grew up in the 1980s with this idea that, like, I was supposed to find my calling and do what I love and have this exciting career based on it. But also, like, my parents were still a little bit based in that earlier time, you know, child of boomers. And so it was like, you know, I would constantly get this message of, like, do what you want to do. Oh, but you can't do that. That won't make you real money. So, you know, I told my parents, like, I want to be a writer. They're like, you can't do that. And I was like, well, okay, then what is this garbage? And when I look back on that now, right, it's obvious that there is sort of a turning point in how we think about work. And we have these sort of grand narratives about what work is and what it's for, that are created through struggle, right? That this is not just something that's handed down from above, but it's also not just something that we inherently believe and feel and have always, as humans, sort of throughout history, felt this way about work. Like, at one time, work was something that people were forced into doing because the common land was fenced off and turned into private property. And so then, you know, a lot of us who were not the lucky ones who did the fencing off, sorry, siren going by. Sorry about that. I hope you added a little bit. So if we were not the lucky ones who got to do the enclosing, that meant we were left with sort of nothing but the power of our labor to sell in order to make a living. And that's where wage labor comes from, right? It doesn't come from humans sitting around going, gee, I'm really bored today. What could I do in order to be less bored? And so the idea that that will then therefore, like, be sort of meaningful and fulfilling isn't an eternal prospect. In fact, it's a relatively new one for most parts of the economy. And it became so prevalent because the previous sort of bargain around work is going away, at least in countries like the US and the UK and these sort of post-industrial nations, where the industrial job is largely a thing of the past, right? The UK deindustrialized faster than anywhere else. The US is, you know, also still in the process of it, but also did it very quickly. And the industrial work ethic was a different thing, right? Nobody expected you to love going to the factory. That was not the deal you made. The deal you made was that you would get paid enough to live on, something that, like, at least after years and years of sort of union battles, approximated a meaningful, you know, pay for your work. Not that you would go in and the work itself would be pleasurable. That didn't factor into it. And according to factory workers that I've talked to, you know, it was almost seemed like the opposite. It almost seemed like they resented you if you had a good time. So this idea now that people like me and you will do this work because we love it, that comes in as industrial jobs go out. And it is in some ways, you know, just a simple tool of motivation from the boss. In other ways, it's a genuine response to things that people were saying when they were protesting against industrial jobs, right? These jobs suck. They're boring. They suck the life out of you. They, you know, break your body and dull your spirit and all of that stuff. And people were saying, I want to do something more meaningful with my day than do this 100 times over and over again, right? Lifting your arms up to, you know, screw in a bolt or whatever it is your part of the assembly line is. So instead of saying like, oh, well, maybe we could like do less work and then we would have more time to decide what we might want to do, instead we get sold the idea that work is itself going to be meaningful now. So you're going to find meaning in your work. And meanwhile, we're actually working longer hours than we used to. People have multiple jobs. People have side hustles, right? Dolly Parton, who originally wrote 9 to 5, rewrites it as 5 to 9. And you're just like, Dolly, Dolly, what you doing, Dolly? Right? Because like the point of 9 to 5 is that the 9 to 5 job sucks. And then you to add like the 5 to 9 hustle on top of it is like, oh, well, if I just like work more, then I'll find the thing that's meaningful in my work. And I mean, you just see how obvious that is when you add the extra hours to the day, that what's happening is it's just encouraging more work.
Right, right. And it's also what it does and what you show so well in your book is it puts huge pressure on the individual, I mm-hmm. think, to yeah. self-actualize, to be exactly. this kind of fully formed human being who knows what they want, who knows how to get it. And I think this is especially true for women, you know, mm-hmm. as good kind of liberated subjects,
right.
Post-feminist subjects, even we are expected to be a girl boss, to lean in, mm-hmm. To get the job, have the family maybe as well.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, what might be lost in all of this, in addition to all the things we've already mentioned is, during the kind of Fordist bargain phase of industrial capitalism, when people didn't maybe expect to love their work, they did it because they had to. There was kind of value in the struggle against mm-hmm. capital.
Yes,
that exactly. is embodied in what it means to be in a union and mm-hmm. fight for rights.
Yeah,
I mean, these days it feels like we don't. That struggle, instead of being a feature of our external environment, has been internalized. Maybe this is getting mm-hmm. a little psychoanalytic, but
it's no, not at all.
The pressure that's put on the individual is to kind of contain all of that within themselves.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I think a certain brand of feminism has a lot to answer for in doing this, right? Because like, this is part of what I mean of sort of capitalism internalizing protest movements, but also, you know, because there was never just one argument about women and work coming out of feminism writ large, right? As a movement, there were people who had all sorts of responses to this idea that like the answer to, you know, what Betty Friedan called the feminine mystique is for women to leave the house and get a job. Because housework sucks, we should go get paid for work. And this was always a story of a certain kind of middle-class college-educated woman who expected, if she joined the workforce, to get the same kind of job that her husband had, to get a job, in other words, like this, right? Where you put on a blazer and you talk real smart and like you get mm-hmm. sort of social capital out of it. And look, like I have one of those jobs now. Like I get the appeal of it. I do, you know, understand that like there is sort of pleasure and meaning and also power, which we don't like to talk about as much, in this, right? But for the vast majority of women who are in the workforce, they don't get to do that. And even people like me, I'm not making that much money. I like to tell you, writing books these days, it doesn't pay what it used to. And so the vast majority of women who are in the workforce are doing some sort of feminized, gendered labor that doesn't pay very much. And so what happened when you sort of accept that going into the workforce is in itself a good thing, without questioning what are those jobs going to be? What is it actually that we wanted from them? You're just going to end up pushing a lot of women into crappy jobs. And this happened over and over again in public policy, right? Like, this is what welfare reform is, which I will like never, ever, ever stop complaining about, which was bipartisan policy, right? That like, you know, feminists did critique it because it was obvious from the beginning what it was going to do, but it was nowhere near the top priority of the movement. And, you know, the welfare rights movement of the 1970s, again, was a very different kind of feminist movement that instead of arguing that women should go get jobs, actually said, like, we've got jobs. Like, taking care of kids and raising a family and being present in my community is actually important. And that is also something that we should support as a society. And that is why people are actually entitled to get support. And so now, you know, one of the big things that's happened in the last year in the Biden administration is that they've implicitly sort of said the welfare rights movement was right, because now we've got a child allowance for the first time in American history. They're actually paying money to people who have kids, to everyone, right? That you will get this money. It will be paid to you regularly rather than just a tax deduction that you can take if you are well off enough to take tax deductions. It's actually going to be money in people's hands, because we've realized, because of the pandemic, again, because like women, when everybody was forced into the home, women are still picking up most of the slack. Realize that this is unsustainable, that we can't actually have a society that forces everybody to be in the workforce and also makes no provision for taking care of children. And that it's work and it's hard and it requires support. And that even people like me who don't have children, we are invested in that as a society, that children should be born and be supported and be taken care of, and that the people who do that should be treated well and with respect and given what they need in order to do that right. So, you know, I think to talk about the way that this gets internalized, you can sort of look at the welfare reform argument, which was essentially that, like, you need to go get work. And if you're not working in a job that gives you wages, you are somehow not as good. You are not as worthy. The way that this all gets, you know, twisted around, and the, you know, the irony being, of course, that it's Black women that are the face of welfare reform, right? That they're demonizing Ronald Reagan's welfare queen. And to say in America that Black women have not done enough work historically is pretty screwed up for so many reasons, starting with, I don't know, chattel slavery, right? So this, the way that this racist, sexist policy got enacted by, again, it was a deal between Bill Clinton and Newt Gingrich, that tells us so much about the fact that, like, work is actually still coerced, even as they say, like, oh, you'll find more meaning in these women who get jobs. They'll be like more, you know, they'll have more self-respect or something. Yeah, if work gave you self-respect and an awesome life, why do you have to, like, still right now cut off unemployment benefits to force people back into the workplace?
Right, right, exactly. And another thing that just popped into my brain while you were talking, there seems to be some irony as well in the fact that women's work in particular, or sort of feminized labor, the labor of care, especially, has been kind of reified in this sort of neoliberal economy, at the same time as its original application, like within the home, has been devalued.
Yeah. Right.
And that's a really difficult thing to kind of get your head around. So can you talk a little bit more about the ways in which this feminized labor is kind of playing out at the moment, maybe particularly in the context of the pandemic?
Yeah, I think one of the important things to understand is that, like, gender didn't create the division of labor. The division of labor created gender. So when we think about like human society splitting people into two groups of people, one of which is responsible for the babies and one of which is responsible for the other things. It was, I mean, first of all, it was never just like, here's work and here's child raising, right? That comes with capitalism. But the division of labor itself sort of then ends up imputing all of these characteristics to the people who do one job. So I am, in some sense, not a woman because I don't have children, right? This is why people sort of react very oddly to somebody who appears to be of childbearing age when they're like, oh, are you gonna have kids? And I'm like, no, what's wrong with you? You know, there's something must be wrong with me for not wanting to have children, because that's what we think of as women, right? And so that has held up, right, even through this push to get women into the workforce. And it's one of the things that I've thought about so much in the last, you know, several months, is that like the way that this sort of both like shortchanges men and lets them off the hook by implying that men can't do caring labor. And all of the male teachers and nurses and nurses aides out there that I know that I've talked to would very much dispute that, right? But also like in, you know, there was this New York Times big section on women losing their minds. It was titled Primal Scream. And the big feature article in it sort of profiles these three women, one of whom is a single mother and two of whom are married to men. And the men just like lie on the couch while the baby screams. And I'm like, I would have thrown a frying pan at him, which is why I'm single. but you know, you just like, why is he like, you know, like there's this one story, like this guy comes in and the woman is sitting there at the dining room table with her laptop open with the kid on a computer next to her. And like the husband sort of wanders by and is like, oh, they're calling on the kid, as he like leans over to see what's going on. And I'm like, you help the kid, you know? But like, that's just so naturalized that she doesn't backhand him. I mean, that would be abuse, but still, like, you know, like I just can't imagine sitting there and like absorbing that and thinking, why do you think you can't do that? You know, but also like to stop picking on men for a minute. I actually like the people who sort of checked in on me and emotionally supported me because I was on lockdown by myself all winter, were men, a lot of them straight men, and like are very caring and concerned and tuned into like other people's feelings and other people's needs. And I think that the idea that they somehow just can't do that, that it's not natural, is just such garbage. And it sort of, it does that work of reifying, right? Women are just, we're just better at this stuff. So we just should do it because we're better at it, because natural. And if anybody has ever seen me hold a baby, you will know that it is not natural at all to know what to do when somebody puts a very tiny, fragile human being in your arms. And I'm just like, I'm going to break it. And yeah, and it's so depressing to sort of see here is where we are in 2021, that like women are leaving the workforce because the burden of childcare has all been placed back on them. And that's just like, not that I think necessarily, again, that being in the workforce is a great place to be, but why is it in the year of our, you know, Angela Davis 2021, like we still think that this is how the division is just gonna go? And like part of that is also that like women still make less money. And so if one partner is going to have to leave the workforce, the one who makes less money is going to be the one who does that. And it's still most likely to be the woman who is penalized for having children in the first place. Like, you know, all of these things feed into each other, and they just like, they are doing nobody any good at this point.
Right. So before we turn to Catherine Angel's recent book, I want to ask you about, just to kind of elaborate on something that you write about in the book, and that is how the rise of this kind of labor of love ideology has really emerged from capital absorbing critiques of its practices over the years, particularly, I guess, since the 1970s, the 60s or the 70s. Yeah. Can you just trace that emergence for us a little bit?
Yeah, so I borrow this idea from the French sociologists Luc Boltanski and Yves Chapello, whose book The New Spirit of Capitalism sort of talks about these shifts between ideas of what work is for, about what capitalism is for, that are sort of justifications for a system that produces, of course, like massive inequality. It needs to be justified to us so that we continue to operate within it. And so that means that when protests, when critiques sort of arise, that they have to be handled in some way or another. They either have to be sort of squashed out completely, or they have to be internalized. This is what Marx wrote about as the dialectic, right? Of like, you will have the resistance to the thing. Eventually there will be some sort of synthesis. So, you know, for however many years we got a sort of agreement that capital would put up with workers having unions as long as those unions didn't demand to control the workplace. But then what ends up happening is a profit squeeze in the 1970s, and capital starts going, well, maybe we just will actually try to slowly destroy the unions and move the work to places that aren't already unionized. So that's what deindustrialization and deunionization are. And recent research by people like Lane Wyndham has pointed out that the deunionization part is a very big, important part of that, that it wasn't just that they like moved businesses, but they actually got much, much better and much more strategic and concerted and spent a lot more money on union busting, just direct union busting. And we're still seeing that today. But so what comes out of the 60s in particular, and I always return to the Lordstown factory in Ohio, right outside of Youngstown, because it was sort of this iconic General Motors plant where they made cars for, it opened in 1966 and it just closed in 2019. So it was, for a variety of very interesting reasons, sort of the site of a lot of protest and rebellion in the late 60s and early 70s, where you had this sort of very young workforce. You also had a lot of people who had come from Appalachia, from like the mining culture, which had very, very militant unions. It was an interracial workforce, and it was really over this whole industrial labor thing. So you had wildcat strikes all the time. One of the guys I interviewed, Tim O'Hara, who is the former president of the union local at Lordstown, was telling me he started work there in 1970 or 1972. And his brother started work like basically right when it opened. And he was like, yeah, so we'd be sitting around the dinner table and my brother would have left for the, you know, the evening shift 2 hours before. And he like walks back in and sits down for dinner. And we're like, aren't you supposed to be working? And he's like, ah, yeah, but they fired Billy. So we all walked off the job. And it was kind of that culture. Another guy who had worked there from the beginning told me about one time the workers stuck one of their managers on a train going to the East Coast. So, you know, it was a hotbed of rebellion, shall we say. And it was this, you know, they wanted more security and things like that. But really what they were rebelling against was this entire sort of culture of just management gets to do whatever it wants and we have to take it. So they were rebelling against the speed up where they would just, you know, move more and more cars down the assembly line. So you would have to do this faster all day. And that can really cause a lot of injuries. But it was, you know, there were discussions, there were a lot of conversations around that time. Also in Italy, the autonomous movement, things like that, where factory workers were like, maybe this just isn't a good way to spend your life. And maybe even if you get a good wage and can buy a house and send your kid to college or whatever, it actually still sucks. And so that gets, you know, played out in these wildcat strikes where even sort of the union leadership didn't really understand why the workers were going on strike. They're like, you have a good deal. Why are you complaining? And, you know, their complaints were sort of more existential. Mm. And so, you know, that idea that you don't want to have a boss, well, now look what Uber's selling us, right? Uber is selling us that you're your own boss. You're an independent contractor. You don't work for us. But what that actually means in practice is what, you know, Vina Dubal and others have called like sharecropping, essentially, right? You have to pay for your car, you have to pay for your gas, you have to pay for all the wear and tear on your car, and you get paid only for the period of time when you are literally driving somebody from point A to point B. And Uber decides how much the fare is. Uber decides how much you get out of the fare. Uber decides how much of your tip you get to keep. And you don't get to set any of those things, where if you were actually your own boss, you would.
Absolutely. It strikes me as not a coincidence that the rise of this ideology was happening at the same time as the rise of marketing as an industry.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And they've, what's happened is they've sold precarity as flexibility, mm-hmm. you know, and that seems to be particularly insidious at this moment. Let's move on a little bit now to this connection I wanted to make between your work and Catherine Angel's. Yes. So listeners to the show may have heard my interview with Catherine a couple of months ago. She's the author of Tomorrow Sex Will Be Good Again, was out this year from Verso. And this book is, you know, it contains a really powerful critique of modern consent culture mm-hmm. when it comes to sex. And she's obviously not suggesting that consent isn't important, but it's more the way that we've constructed consent actually puts a huge amount of pressure on people, especially women, to know exactly what they want, you know, mm-hmm. in sex and love. And I think by extension, to know exactly what they want from life. And, you know, Sarah, you began this interview talking about being a child of the 1980s. I am too. I was raised by baby boomers who, and I think we were probably both raised in this atmosphere mm-hmm. of the world is your oyster, you know, you can do anything you want. We've had the end of history, and now we've just got this wide, expansive world that kind of opens out onto our generation. And it's taken me a very long time to realize that that was rather oppressive and in many ways coercive. So I wonder if you can help me draw out some connections mm-hmm. between Catherine's idea that, you know, we've been sold this idea that we have to do everything alone. We have to come up with who we are, what we want by ourselves. And we go out into the world and we extract it.
Yes.
How's that playing out in labor?
Yeah, I love that book. Everyone should read it. It's not very long and it's just very thoughtful about the fact that like desire is not something that sort of springs from your head fully formed like Athena from Zeus, right? That these are actually things that are constructed between people. This is why I hate dating apps, by the way. Because it assumes that you have like a checklist in your head of what you want, then you know what that is in advance somehow. And then you go out and get it. And it treats people as means to an end other than ends in themselves, to get like Kant for a second. I can't believe I just did that. I did not really study philosophy or anything, but one of the few things I remember. Also, it just assumes that things, feelings, emotions, needs, desires are sort of individual products of our own mind and not products of social interaction, where like if there is one thing I have been going on about this entire thing is the threads of social interaction that shape everything. So like how we think about the world that we live in is shaped by the interactions we have, the power dynamics that we exist under, the people that we know and talk to and have sort of conversations with. This is a digression that I swear makes a point, have been following the news of the New York City mayoral election, and people have sort of been extrapolating just like, oh, people voted for Eric Adams and therefore like working class voters of color don't actually want police reform. And I'm like, Eric Adams, who I am no fan of, but like Eric Adams is the kind of politician who shows up to things, you know? And that's actually meaningful to people because like you know who this person is, or you at least know that they come to the picket line in your neighborhood. You know, they know that you show up at the you know community barbecue. They know who you are, and those relationships can actually change how we think about things. That's why door knocking is so important in politics. So all of these ways that we have sort of been taught In the book, I talk about sort of Margaret Thatcher's famous statement, right, that there's no such thing as society. There are individual men and women, and there are families. And like, you know, what pandemic life did to us was make us live that way. Mm. And it sucked. It was terrible, right? Living alone for a winter was awful. But also, like, when I was living with housemates during the first lockdown, like, we wanted to kill each other. When it was like, human relationships are just not meant to be this small and narrow and closed off. Like, actually, like, the expansion of our desires comes from contact with other people and new things. It doesn't come from just sitting around in your room by yourself, because if it did, this winter would have been awesome. We would have all had a great time. But that's not actually what happens, right? What ends up happening is you run out of things to say because you've done nothing all week except work, and it sucked. And so, yeah, I think the neoliberal project, I don't remember who was the first one to sort of say this, but several people have pointed out that the real goal of neoliberalism was to destroy solidarity. This is where the union busting comes in, the outsourcing, the be your own boss. This is where, you know, a certain kind of boss would love work from home to be permanent, because then you never see your coworkers and everybody's sort of isolated. And so this is the tension right now, is we're going back to the workplace. It's like, do we want to go back to the office? What are the pros of that? What are the cons of that from like the standpoint of workers who might want to have some collective power, because that's the only way you have power against your boss. So yeah, I think to think about what we might want other than just more individual fulfillment through work and possibly a dating app, we actually have to return to the social. And so I think about like the massive, massive protests last summer, right? After several months of lockdown, after so much death and destruction, there was obviously so much grief and anger and rage in those protests, but there was also a lot of joy at being around people again.
Yeah.
At like being in a collective space with people with purpose, that like, that's sort of what people try to sell you when they tell you that you find meaning in work, right? Is, oh, you're like working with other people to like have a, do something purposeful. And this is like, you know, people who have like questioned my critique of work will often be like, well, don't people need meaning? And it's like, where was the last place you found meaning? Because for a lot of us, you know, going out into the streets was the thing that gave us actual meaning. And that wasn't work, despite all the conspiracy theories that we're all being paid by George Soros. it's something else entirely, right?
Yeah.
And that's different. And that's actually, that's the thing that's the human need, is to be and connect with other people. It's not to like have a checklist of your desires and your goals and tape that up over your desk and visualize it every day so that you can be your best self or whatever. It's something very, very different. And neoliberalism in particular, capitalism in general, wants to squash that because it gets in the way of capital accumulation by a few.
Right, right. That's so well said. Exactly, especially this idea of desire emerging in relation to other people, in relation to our context and our environment, and the fact that this is a process. It's not an outcome. It's not a sort of static state that we inhabit and then bring to the world. It's actually something that comes out of our encounter with the world. Right. And that's what solidarity is as well. And so I think that's a really great note to end on. I was going to ask you what your kind of call to action is in this book, but I think that's it.
Unionize your workplace. That's always a good call to action.
Right. And realizing, I think you say in the conclusion, you know, work won't love you back, but people will.
Yeah.
And relationships are, you know, they are the real sort of texture of our lives. So that's great. Is there anything else you'd like to say? Can you tell listeners how to find your work or anything that you want to plug, how to find you on Twitter as well?
Yes, on Twitter, I am Sarah L. Jaffe, SarahLJaffe. And you can find me and more about the book, including where to order it, at workwon'tloveyouback.org.
Excellent. Okay. Thank you so much, Sarah.
Thank you.
I'll let you go, but take care. And yeah, thanks again for joining us.
All right. Thanks so much.
Okay. Bye.